Great. Well, I think it's about time to get started. Thanks everyone for joining tonight. This is being recorded and we have a little bit of an introduction. So if anyone steps in late, that's totally fine. Of course, Michael Dillon's favorite shelter is Taft. My name is Lauren. My name is Lauren. I'm the volunteer and education coordinator with the Green Mountain Club. I've worked at the Green Mountain Club for about 3.5 years. And as a part of my role, I put on educational workshops. We haven't been able to do many of them, if at all, in person this year, but we've had a really great slate of virtual events lined up to keep you all busy and occupied and educated at home. And one of the best ones, and probably the best ones that I've enjoyed doing, is these artwork workshops with Kati. So Kati, maybe a quick introduction from you, and then I got a couple more things to run through.
Yeah, sure. I've been having so much fun doing these workshops too with you, Lauren. So hi, everybody. My name's Kati. I'm a watercolor artist. And in the spring, summer, and fall, I'm a caretaker for the Green Mountain Club. I was at Stratton Pond in 2019, and I was the Southern lead this year in 2020. I'm also an artist in the off season and all the seasons, but I'm, you know, only an artist in the off season, and it's pretty great. And I've been painting my whole life, and I love bringing watercolors out onto the trail with me. So if you see me in the summer, I'll either be shoveling poop or painting.
That's exactly true. And thank you so much, Kati. It's been really good to do these with you. And I feel like even in the off season, we're getting to see each other more, which is super fun. So I appreciate it. And for those of you that are joining back that have come to this before or come to another event, thanks for coming out. These are really a highlight. Highlight of my COVID pandemic era is to see familiar faces and to see new faces on a screen as we just do something fun and enjoyable for an hour. So thanks again. There's two questions in the bottom right there. We'd love to know if you have a favorite shelter on the Long Trail and what you're using to paint with. I assume a lot of people are using watercolor, but if there's something else that you're working with, then let us know. Also, as Kati said, she's pretty good at this stuff. So if you have any questions before we get started, it's a good time now to put them in the chat box and get those answered so that you can get your stuff. There's a list of materials on the right there. Kati, let me know if anything's missing, but everyone grab those and we would be able to get going in a couple minutes.
Yeah, I would love to add a pencil onto the list this time because what we're gonna do is first sketch out our shelter and our tree so we kind of know where all the paint goes. So a pencil and an eraser are gonna be extra helpful for this one.
Great. Thanks, Kati. A couple other quick notes. This program tonight here is sponsored by Burlington Beer Company. That's what that other logo is next to the Green Mountain Club's logo. Burlington Beer Company has been a supporter of the GMC since about the middle of last year. And they're a brewery located in Burlington, Vermont. They created a collaboration beer. They created a collaboration beer, which all sales, a portion of the proceeds go to the Green Mountain Club, both from Burlington Beer Company and from the distributor of that beverage. And so we've gotten a lot of really amazing donations and funds from Burlington Beer Company. That beverage is called Vaulted Blue. So if you're ever at the store and you're looking for a good Vermont beer, then the Vaulted Blue tastes good and is also a great way to support the Green Mountain Club and the Long Trail. We just got a check from them last week for $5,000, which for those of you that don't know, $5,000 will fund an entire week of trail crew. So $5,000 equates to X number of steps, to X number of bog bridging, to X number of new trail. And it's a really great thing. Anna asked for a flavor description. Yeah, it's a good, you know, American IPA. It's about 5.5%, so not too heavy, and got a really nice floral fruity flavor. So I definitely suggest checking that out and supporting Burlington Beer Company. They've been really helpful to the GMC and great for various events and other things that we've had in person. And I'm not drinking one right now that would affect my painting abilities. So a quick spiel of the Green Mountain Club. For those of you that don't know, or maybe this is your first time joining, the Green Mountain Club was founded in 1910. It's the organization that built and continues to maintain Vermont's Long Trail, which goes from the Massachusetts border to the Canadian border. Green Mountain Club also takes care of the Appalachian Trail in Vermont, about 166 miles of side trail that access the Long Trail, and a system of trails in the Northeast Kingdom. We steward over 25,000 acres of conserved land. And beginning in 1980, we worked on protecting the entire Long Trail. And to this point today, there's only about 5.5 miles of the Long Trail system that are on unprotected land. So we're working towards making that zero so that the Long Trail can continue to be free and available for all that choose to use it. Katie was talking about stirring poop. That's what our caretakers do. Our trail crew are the ones that build and rebuild areas of trail that might need work to be done on them. I believe there's a couple of trail crew members in the audience right now, so thanks very much for your work. That photo on the bottom is a 2018 crew. One on the top, you can tell, is a little bit later, a caretaker crew up on a mountain. And they're a great source of just inspiration and care for the Long Trail. The Long Trail would not be the same thing if it wasn't for the caretaker program. We're in our 51st year of the caretaker program as it is today. It started in 1969. So if you're looking for a summer of fun and joy, or if you know somebody in your life that would benefit from that, we are starting hiring in just a couple weeks. Green Mountain Club takes care of shelters and privies. We're gonna learn a lot about those tonight, so I won't go too much further in detail. Katie, I think I've shown you that one on the right. That's the beautiful Stratton Pond privy photo taken by Lee Allen. And then we have...
Oh, wow.
Yes, exactly. So there's over 70 overnight shelters and privies on the Long Trail. They're important. We need to concentrate our use in places. If we didn't, then we'd have dispersed camping and human-made toilets all over the place. So big part of what the Green Mountain Club does. We don't like that. And then we maintain the trail. The trail needs to be maintained. If a tree falls down, you have to cut it out. As the brush grows in, you have to remove that. And if it wasn't for the Green Mountain Club and for our 1,000-plus volunteers, our 40 seasonal field staff, we wouldn't be able to welcome over 200,000 people to the Long Trail every single year. So it takes a lot of work. It takes a lot of effort, but it's going really well. Despite some challenges, this was a really good year. We got a lot of great work done because of our volunteers, because of our staff. And we're still able to welcome people to the trail. Well, I think that's my introduction there, Katie. One quick thing I'll do is I'm going to pop up a poll on everyone's screen. So if you haven't done a Zoom with me yet, you know that I like these. I think they're fun. So take a look at the screen. Got a couple questions. One of them is kind of a trivia style question. There's no pressure if you don't get it right. And the other two are just to get to know you folks a little bit. While you're doing that, I'm going to give a quick Zoom introduction. You've probably figured out by this point that when you joined, you were muted. We're going to keep you on mute while we do, like dogs and crying babies are all part of life. It's nice to not have them interrupt the program. So if you have a question or if you have a comment, then use the chat box. That's on the bottom of your screen. Just type chat. You can type your question right in there. As Katie's going through and instructing you all on excellent, beautiful art, then I will be able to watch the chat box and answer any questions or comments that you might have. That's pretty much it. You should be able to change your screen as well. I think it should be happening now, but when we go back to Katie, her artwork picture will be big on the center of your screen. If you have any troubles making that happen, then just write it in the chat box. We can figure it out, but definitely nice to have that as your center screen. Great. I'm going to stop sharing, Katie, and then we can get yours loaded up.
All right.
And let's see. We got most of our votes in, too. Oh, okay. Thank you all for participating in the poll. Let's see what we got. Wow, look at that balance. Half and half. Thank you so much for all the returners and all the new people that have come. It's great to have you here. Taft Lodge, many of you are right. Taft Lodge just turned 100 years old this year. It was built in 1920. And then cross-country skiing is a favorite thing. That's great. I have not got out on my skis yet this year, but it's definitely happening in the next week or so. So thanks for your participation. And you can take it away, Katie.
All right. Cool. So the painting that we're going to be doing today is of a Long Trail shelter with some lovely snow on it and some cardinals and a tree. This was based off of a picture of, I think, whiteface shelter that I found on the internet, but it could be any shelter that you want it to be, as long as it's, you know, a log three-sided lean-to. This is not Stratton Pond shelter, but if you want to paint Stratton Pond shelter, go for it. I'm just not going to be instructing that today. I'll just give you a quick run through on my materials that I've got out here, and then we will get started. So like I said before, I've got a pencil and an eraser to sketch out our shelter and our tree first. Then I've got a variety of brushes. If you only have one, that's totally fine. If you have 40, that's awesome too. But basically I'm going to be using a big brush and a medium brush and a couple of different small brushes, like a, you know, a semi-small one for the trees and then a really tiny one for the birds. I've got a cup full of clean water over here. You can tell it's the cup I use all the time because it's kind of stained. I've got a paper towel. You can also use like a bandana or a scrap of cloth, something just to absorb water from your brush. And then a set of watercolors. And everyone's watercolors is probably going to look a little bit different, but as long as you've got green, blue, brown, and red, those are pretty much the only colors that we're going to be using this evening. As we go through, I'm going to be walking you through this step by step. If you decide that you don't want to do something, like if you're just not into the birds, you don't have to do them. And if you decide that you want to add something in the background or make two shelters or something, like this is your painting. You can do whatever you want here. So you're just have fun with it. All right. So let's get started. With our pencil, we're going to sketch out our shelter. Okay, great. So I'm gonna start by drawing the back end of my shelter. So the back end is gonna be shorter than the front end. So that's just something to kind of remember. On my 9x12 piece of paper, the back end of my shelter is gonna be maybe 1.5 inches, 2 inches tall. And that's gonna be over here on the left-hand side of my paper. And just a line like that. So hopefully everybody can see that. Hopefully that shows up well enough. I'm going to draw my lines a little bit bolder than what I normally would. What I'm going to recommend that you folks all do is just, you know, not use a lot of pressure with your pencil. Keep it like nice and light and sketchy so that it's easy to erase or paint over. But I'm going to do some big bold lines so that you can see what I'm doing. All right. And then I want the front log of my shelter to go maybe to about the halfway point of the painting. So I'm going to draw the bottom of my shelter to about over there or so. So I've just got an L on the bottom of my paper, nothing crazy yet. All right, then I'm gonna make a little curve for the front of that log. So not quite a straight line, just a little bit of a curve because the log is, you know, rounded on the end. And that's maybe a third as high as the back of my shelter because that's gonna end up being like three logs high. So this is the first log over here. And then I'm just gonna draw a light line back just so that I know like that's the first log and that's where it's going. Okay. All right, then we're gonna draw the front of the shelter. So this is gonna go maybe another 1/2 inch, like maybe a log or a log and a half higher than the back of the shelter. And it's not right from the front of that front log, it's gonna be back maybe 1/2 inch or so. And so we'll go up like that. I find it easier to draw straight lines if I'm going down rather than up. As you can see here, when I was going up, it kind of turned into a branch rather than a straight line, but maybe that's helpful for you, maybe not. All right, then the front of my roof, the overhang, that's gonna be a nice right angle. It's gonna go out a bit past the edge of the log here. So just another L. Lovely, L for lovely. And then I want the peak of my roof to be not quite in the middle of the whole structure, right? It's gonna be more towards the front, but still a little bit behind like the front edge of what I've already drawn here. So I'm gonna aim for the peak to be like maybe here. If you wanna draw a dot for where you're going, that's awesome. If that's not helpful, then that's totally fine too. And so I'm gonna draw up to that dot. The front of my roof. And that might be a bit of an aggressively sharp roof, but that's okay. Yeah, actually, I'm gonna calm that down just a little bit. I don't want it to be quite that pointy. Okay. And that's what the eraser is for too. Lovely. And then I'm going to take the back of, or the rest of the roof, and just aim towards the back of my shelter with it. So just like that. Neat. Look at that. You drew a long trail shelter.
How'd you do that, Kati? We all just drew a shelter. That's amazing.
You guys are awesome. All right, we're just going to sketch in a couple of details. So we've got our front support here that's holding the roof up, and it also looks pretty, and it's a good place for the bird to sit. So this is just going to be a line that goes from the front of the roof and comes down something like that, maybe about halfway down the front log of the shelter. I'm going to get rid of that line. And then I'm also going to sketch in this front supporting log. I wish I knew the names for what the parts of buildings were, but I don't, so that's okay. Just going to sketch that in so I know where it is. All right. And then I'm going to go to the back of my shelter, and these three circles are the ends of the logs that are facing us. These are the back of the shelter, right? So this is the sawn off end of the log that's facing us. So I'm just going to draw three circles, almost but not quite touching the back of the shelter. And if your circles are uneven or if they're not perfect circles, that's okay. This is a rustic backcountry shelter. It's not going to be exactly perfect. You know, people went out into the woods with handsaws and hammers and built this, so. They do a great job, but they don't have like super precision tools like you'd have on a house. And one more fun detail that we can do on the back is just round off three logs for the back of the shelter also. So I'll start with this bottom log because I've already kind of sketched where it goes. So I'm just going to draw a nice little curve, a semicircle. And then I'll do that two more times. And so then that is, those make the ends of these logs, right? And then we can erase that line. There we go. And if you want to, you can sketch in where your logs are going to be. We're also going to do this with paint, so you don't need to sketch those in. But if it helps for you to see like where your logs are going to be, then that's fine. You can go ahead and do that. All right, now give you all a second to finish up your shelter, and then we will go and draw our tree next. And then we'll get to the paint, don't worry.
This is the easier part for me, Kati, so that's okay. I can handle this.
You're all doing a great job, I'm sure. I can't see any of your drawings yet, but I'm sure they're wonderful.
We can do at some point, have everyone pick them up and show them to us. That's very nice.
That's my favorite part at the end.
Because they're all beautiful. It doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. Could even be a painting of like, I don't know. I was about to think of a shelter that wouldn't be very pleasant to paint, but that's not a very nice thing about that shelter. I shouldn't say that. Should be nice to all the shelters.
Yes. Some would be more difficult to paint than others. Some are a little more complicated.
Governor Clement would be interesting.
Oh, yeah.
All that rock.
That would be so fun. Maybe next time we'll do that one. It's just a bunch of ovals. That's all it is.
It's just blobs.
Exactly. It's just blobs. All of painting is blobs.
If you haven't joined before, then everyone should know that Kati says that all of painting is blobs. So if you're having trouble painting, then just paint blobs.
Yep. And it'll look like something. Probably trees, because trees are pretty much blobs. Mm-hmm. Speaking of trees, let's draw a tree. So the tree that we're making is going to be basically just like a Christmas tree. So here we go. So the basic shape that we want is just like the, you know, this kind of thing. But we're going to make it a little bit prettier than that. But that's basically all we're doing. So let's draw a straight line to be our trunk, just so we know how big our tree is going to be. And so it's going to be, our tree is closer to us than our shelter is. So it's going to end closer to the bottom of the painting. And I want the top of my tree to be maybe level with halfway up the front of the roof, if that makes sense. So you can just sketch in a little line for your tree trunk. And then I'm going to go down one side and then the other side, just kind of making these like nice little curved shapes, I guess. So these are the branches as they're kind of fluffing out from the edge of the tree. And they're going to get a little bit wider. They're going to go out further, the further down the tree we go. Right, so trees are smaller at the top and bigger at the bottom. And then I'll do pretty much the same thing on the other side. It does not have to be an exact mirror image. In fact, it probably shouldn't be, because if you came upon a tree in the woods that was completely symmetrical, that would be weird. That's just not how trees grow. So if it's a little bit funky and uneven, then that's good. You've drawn a tree. And then at the bottom, I'm just going to make kind of a squiggly scribble to be the bottom of the branches. Lovely. Then I will erase my tree trunk, because that was just kind of so I knew where the middle of my tree was and I knew where to go. And we're gonna give ourselves a little bit of a shortcut here. So when we paint our tree, the way that we're gonna make it so that there's snow on the tree is we're just gonna leave that white. So what's gonna be helpful now is if we kind of sketch out some blobs where we want the white to be so that we know later on to not paint those. Because I found that when you're painting snow on a tree like this, it's really easy to paint too much green and then you haven't left any snow. So what I'm gonna do is just kind of sketch in some blobby areas that maybe go across kind of like so. And if you've painted snow on a tree before and you feel like you have a handle on it, feel free to skip drawing in the blobs. But I think that it's helpful. So yeah, I'm gonna draw some that start kind of like on the top of the branch and then go across the tree and then like this. And if you wanna remember where your green is supposed to be, you can just sketch in like a really small G where you're gonna be painting the green part of the tree. So it's almost like a paint by number, but not really. It's a paint by number that you're making yourself. All right, and be sure to sketch those blobs in pretty lightly, because when you get to painting the actual tree, you might decide to kind of cover those up a little bit or leave more white or change it up or something. So don't commit too hard to those. These are just to help ourselves out in the future. I'll give you all a minute to just finish sketching that tree, and then we will be starting in with our paint momentarily.
I'm going to say one thing, Katie. Yeah. Maybe next time, I guess I should have thought of it for this, but we do have a number of songs of the Green Mountain Club that come from the Green Mountain Club songbook. And that could be interesting to have some singing sessions as well. This feels very, very, I don't know, appreciative of these right now.
Yeah, this is fun. If we do sing out of a songbook, I will not be the one leading the songs. I will listen to all of you sing.
We'll have to find an oboe player. There's oboes that come with them.
Awesome. All right, shall we paint? I'll take that as a yes. Great. So let's all get a medium-sized brush, or maybe your large brush, depending on how large your largest brush is. And we're going to be starting with our shelter. So we're going to paint in all the texture and everything for the first step. So I'm going to take my medium brush, get it wet. And I've got three actually, but I'm going to be using these two browns that are on my palette. I've got like a lighter brown and a darker brown. And then there's one that's kind of yellowy that I'm going to ignore for now. But what I'm basically going to do is just get my brush wet and pick up some of that lighter brown and then pick up some darker brown and kind of mix them in my brush. And then I'm going to go and paint my whole shelter this sort of mixture of light and dark brown. So all I'm going to do is keep grabbing water into my brush and then jumping back onto my palette and picking up that color whenever I start to run out. All right, and don't be afraid to be kind of saturated here, which means you've got a lot of paint in your brush. So you'll get a real strong color. For some other parts of this painting, we're gonna wanna be kind of watery, but right now we can go for some strong color. And I'm not worrying too much about making sure that the entire shelter is the exact same shade of brown. Because again, this is a log shelter in the woods during some weather, it's snowing. So there's gonna be some different light and shadow. There's gonna be different places where the wood has weathered differently. So really I'm just getting the whole thing colored brown. Painted in brown at this point. A really fun and kind of easy way to add texture into your wood while the paint is still wet is you can turn your brush around and use the back end of the brush. And I'm just gonna go back and forth horizontally and kind of scratch in some lines. And this is gonna look like the texture on the wood. And I'll dry off the back of my brush every so often. I don't know how well that's translating in the video. But basically I'm just kind of scribbling back and forth and scratching some paint off and creating a lovely sort of wood grainy texture. If you came to the privy painting back in, what was that, July or something? We did the same technique for the wood on the trees. Not the trees, the privy. And if you were not there, that is not helpful at all. When I'm putting texture into the circles that I drew, I'm just going to do a nice little spiral in them because that's the those concentric rings on the end of the logs. All right, once we've got some texture scratched in there, we can take a smaller brush. So this isn't my smallest brush, but it's pretty small. And I'm gonna get that wet and use just my darker brown to add some shadows in. So this is where I'm gonna be sketching in kind of where the different logs are and maybe adding some shadow underneath the roof. All right, so picking up some water and some dark brown paint off of my palette. And it's okay if your shelter is still a bit wet, because if this paint bleeds a little bit, that's totally fine. It's just gonna look like a shadow that's kind of moving around. So what I'm gonna do first is basically just outline the whole shelter except for the bottom, because the bottom, there's snow coming up on the bottom. So I don't want a dark line down there, but to create a nice shadow, I'm gonna go around the back of my logs, just like that. I'll go around these circles. And then I'll start with my bottom log because I know where that one goes and ends. Just go around the front of it. And then I'll bring that line back. And I can go up and create some more logs. Oh, and then I'll outline this supporting log in the front first. And then I'll paint some logs, or the lines in between the logs. And don't worry about all your logs being the exact same width. It's actually kind of fun to have some thicker and some thinner logs. That makes your painting a bit more interesting. Shadow along the front bottom edge of the roof. So some nice shadows along this supporting log. And maybe two more up here on the top. If you want to add a shadow underneath the left-hand like backside of the roof, we can do that. So I'm just gonna pick up some water on my brush and scrape a bit of it off on my water cup just so it's not super loaded. And then pick up some paint And I don't want this paint to be super duper saturated, so I'm gonna mix it with some water on the plastic part of my palette. And then all I'm gonna do is go along the back end of my shelter and just kind of pull it to the right. And so I'm making it, kind of feathering it a little bit so that it's not just like a straight line up the back of my shelter, right? Kind of pulling it out a bit so that it kind of follows the texture of that wood grain. Yeah, but then it looks like there's a bit of a shadow from the roof onto the logs. And I might add a bit more of that watered down dark brown on the back of these three logs back here, just so it looks shadowed. And if you do that first layer of a shadow and you feel like it's not enough, go ahead and just add another layer. I find with watercolors, it's more effective to add multiple layers of color rather than just like loading up a ton of color on your brush and sticking it on there, because then it tends to look, I don't know, I like it better when it's layers of color rather than just like one solid blob of color. We can do a little bit of a shadow from the front of the roof too. All right. The next thing that we're going to do after your shelter is all done is we're going to add in this background kind of wintry gray, gray-blue background color. Oh dear, I smudged my brown somehow. Well, it's a stick that fell into the snow. That's fine. So if you've got your pencil handy, you can just sketch in kind of where the top of the snow is on the ground real quick. So I'm going to do that. So it's going to start from the bottom of the shelter and then be just kind of a slightly bumpy line that goes out like behind the tree and behind the shelter also. And that's just so I know how far down to paint my background color. Because to create snow, what we're gonna do is just leave the paper white, because white watercolor paint doesn't really show up very well on other watercolor. So it's much easier if we just leave the white paper to look like snow. Yeah. Right. So for our background, you're going to want to grab the biggest brush that you have and get it nice and wet. And we're going to mix up blue and maybe a bit of purple and maybe a bit of black also. So I'm just going to clean off this little piece of my palette. I don't really want green in my snowy background yet. There we go. And you can kind of mix these colors in your brush. You don't have to like mix up all of the color that you need, but I'm just going to mix it up here first so that we have an idea of what color we're looking for. So getting some water in my brush, and I'm going to grab some of this blue over here. If you have an ultramarine blue, I find that that's really the nicest for kind of a snowy purpley background. If you're not sure which one is ultramarine, that's fine. Let me just take a look at both of your blues. I like a mixture of these two blues. I think that's really nice. And then if you've got any purple, add a little bit of purple in. And throughout this whole process of the background, I want to make sure that my brush is nice and wet and that my paint is quite watered down. I don't want this to be a really saturated color. I want this to be pretty watery. So that way we're going to be able to layer our trees on top of it, and it's going to look kind of misty and distant in the background. And then I might add just a little bit of black to gray it down a bit. If you don't have black, you can add maybe a little bit of your darker brown to gray it down. But it might be okay just as your blues and a little bit of purple. If you have a piece of scrap paper handy, which I do, you can test out that color and see if you like it. So I'm pretty pleased with that kind of a color. Hopefully you can see that. Yes, so the roof snow, we're gonna leave that. If you want to draw it with a pencil, you can. I'm gonna just draw the roof snow with my brush, just because it's not as detailed of a item as the shelter or the tree were. So we'll do that first. So once I've got my color mixed up, oh shoot, that's way too much purple. Don't add that much purple into your blue. All right, so let me just mix up that color again real quick. Oops. Tiny bit of purple. All right. Great. Cool, so background color. All right, so my roof, it goes off the back of my shelter, right? It doesn't end where the logs are. So it goes back a little bit. So basically what I'm gonna do is just create a line that goes up like that. Hopefully you can see up from the back of the shelter. And then it's just gonna kind of bump along to the top of the shelter and then down and then to the front. So it's up to you to decide how much snow is on your roof. With this line, that's like a foot and a half of snow on my roof. So I might bring that down a little bit, but I'm not gonna paint below this line except to kind of make there be a little bit less snow on my roof. But I'm just mirroring the shape of the roof, right? So I've got like a nice peak at the front or at the top, and then it kind of is more of a straight line down to meet the front and the back of the roof. Right, and then once I've got where my snow is gonna be, I'm gonna paint everything around that. So right up next to my shelter, gonna go down to my snow line here and stop at the snow. Come around the front. And don't forget to paint this little triangle here between the shelter and that front support of the shelter. And again, remember to keep a wet brush. I mean, you don't want there to be like huge puddles of water on your paper, but we also want this to be a pretty washed out, watery color. But basically all we're doing at this point is coloring in our background. I've started to run out of that color, so I'm just gonna mix up a bit more. Careful with how much purple I put in. And if you mix up another blue that's not the exact same as the blue you had for your background originally, that's okay. As long as it's pretty close, you can just kind of run your brush in between the two colors and that will mix them together on the paper, as long as it's wet. So the bigger your brush is, the easier it's going to be to fill in this background. Okay, Becky, what do I do if I accidentally went below the snow line with blue on the other side of the tree? So I'm guessing that means over here. That is okay. As long as it's wet, you can just take your paper towel and blot it right up and it should come up. If it's starting to dry, just pick up some water. Here, I'll show you. So, oops, I put some blue down there. Uh-oh, it's still nice and wet. So I can just take my paper towel and just blot it right up and it disappears mostly. So that is a pretty easily fixable thing as long as it's still wet. And if it's started to dry, you can just add some more water onto it, kind of scrub it around and then pick it up with the paper towel. That's also a really fun technique for making clouds. If you're painting on your own sometime and you've got a nice blue sky and you want to make clouds, just make sure your sky is wet and then you can just crumple up a paper towel and blot up some clouds and they look really lovely. So free tip for you there. All right, so in just a moment, we're gonna move on to the next step of our painting. So if you're still filling in that background, finish that up. And if you are ready to go on the next part, fantastic. What we're gonna be doing next is our spruce tree here in the front. And we want this paint to be a bit more saturated, so it's not gonna be as watery as we made our background. I'm going to be moving down to a medium to smaller size brush. You don't want to use like a really tiny detail brush for this because it's going to take forever to fill it in. And it's also going to be really hard to like make the proper blobs. So a slightly bigger brush than you think that you need might be a good idea. And if you start and you're like, whoa, Kati, you're crazy, that's too big, go ahead and switch down to a smaller brush. But this is the size brush that I'm using. It's a number 7. All right, so I want to mix up a nice dark kind of sprucey green. So I've got 2 greens in my palette. So I'm going to start by just kind of mixing both of those together. So one green is a little bit more blue and one's a little bit more of a pure green. So I'm picking up a bunch of both of these and mixing it on my palette. And then as you can see, this green is still pretty, that's still a pretty bright green. I want a little bit of a duller, darker green. So I'm gonna take some of my darker blue paint and mix that into my green. And as you can see, that really dulls down that blue or that green, makes it a lot bluer and darker. A much better color if we're painting a spruce tree. So it's just, yeah, so it's more like that. And you can feel free to adjust your color if you feel like there's too much blue in there, add some more green. If there's not enough blue, add more. If you want your green to be much brighter, you can add some yellow into it and less blue. You know, this is your painting, do what you want. But once I've got that green mixed up to how I like it, I'm gonna jump back into my tree. Now I'm gonna remember that I left these white blobs, or I drew in these white blobs because that's where I basically want the snow to be. I'm not gonna go around like exactly where I drew them because that just seems annoying. But what I'm gonna do is fill in those green parts of my painting and just use those white blobs that I drew to be mindful that I want to leave some white areas in my tree. And so as I go around, I can kind of sketch some little branches in. And I'm not using just the very pointy tip of my brush. I'm kind of using the side of my brush. I'm pushing my brush down and then kind of picking it up to use the pointy tip of the brush. And that's giving me a more interesting mark on the paper. And I'm just being mindful of where I wanted to leave snow in the first place. And maybe I'll leave more, or maybe like there, I'll accidentally leave a little bit less, and that's okay. You might need to mix up some more green at some point. And it's fun to maybe sneak in some small blobs of white, like these little white, tiny white patches in my tree. I didn't sketch those out. I'm just making the choice to leave those because it's fun. And then maybe I'll just put a little bit of green inside that blob of white. Now, if this is stressing you out and you're like, whoa, Kati, I cannot even fathom how to think of snow on top of a tree and leaving that white space, you can just like color in your whole tree green. And that's totally fine. You just have a tree that has shed all its snow. Maybe a hiker has come by and just shaken all the snow off the tree onto their friend, because that's a funny thing to do in the winter. And then there's no snow on your tree, and that's okay. Sometimes it's all about the story that you tell about your painting.
Kati, I'm not sure if I want to go for a winter hike together anytime soon.
That's... all the time, but sometimes it's funny.
It is funny sometimes.
One really good branch. And it's also fun to shake snow off a tree, even if you're not aiming it at somebody.
To watch it all cascade and avalanche down is pretty entertaining.
Yeah. So if painting the snow is stressing you out, you can just think about shaking snow off of a tree. I'm having fun going back into my white blobs and adding some just kind of like small little scritchy scratches of green to be like there's little branches poking through the snow. You don't have to do this if you don't want to. I'm also trying to rough up the edges of where those blobs of snow are so that it looks more like tree branchy and not just like circles of white. right, take just a couple more seconds to finish up on your tree. And then we'll move on to the next thing. All right, so our next step is going to be to paint our shelter roof. There's going to be just basically a black line between the snow and the top of the shelter, because right now it looks a little weird. And I like having that black outline. And so it just looks like, you know, the edge of the roof that's poking out. So I'm going to rinse out that same brush that I was using for the tree. You can also switch down to a smaller brush if you'd like to. If you've got black paint, perfect. That's what we'll use. Some palettes don't have black, like this palette doesn't actually have a black paint with it. I have some of my own. But if you don't have black, just mix together your dark brown and your dark blue, and that will get you like a pretty close, it's not gonna be black, but it'll be a close enough color. Something dark. So just picking up some black on this brush. And I don't want this to be terribly drippy and watery. And then all we're gonna do is just paint this outline right between my snow and my shelter. And I want it to be maybe like a quarter of an inch thick, maybe not even quite that much. When I'm painting lines like this, I find it maybe more stressful, but also easier to just paint it in one go rather than trying to sketch it in. So if I just drag my brush all in one line, that's gonna give me the smoothest line. Whereas if I'm like sketching in a line, it tends to kind of, it gets kind of hairy and weird like that. And I'll go down this side of the shelter. And I can go over it multiple times. And that's fine. I think that just makes the shelter look a little bit more finished to have that nice black outline for the roof. Okay, so after our shelter roof is done, we're gonna make our green background forest back here. So these background green trees. So again, very similar to our blue background, we're gonna want these green trees to be rather watery, maybe not quite as watery as the blue-gray background, but definitely more watery than our spruce tree here. I'm gonna pick back up my medium brush and let's see. Clean off a bit of my palette. There we go, clean enough. All right, so this is gonna be a lighter green than my trees here. Pick up some of that brighter green. And then maybe I'll just mix a little bit of my spruce tree green into it just to dull it down a little bit. And then I'll add some water. So I've got a nice watered down, maybe a little bit of yellow for funsies. Yeah, that's a fun color. So So I've got a nice watered down green, which kind of looks like that one. And once you've got a green that you like, we're going to go along our background. These trees are not going to be nearly as detailed as this tree in the front, and they don't have any snow blobs on them, so they should go a little bit quicker and be a little bit easier. But basically, all I'm going to do is paint the top of the trees and then just fill in everything below it, just basically coloring it in, right? So I'm going to go and draw a line for where this first tree trunk is. And I'm right-handed, so I'm going to go from left to right, because that just kind of makes the most sense for me. If you are left-handed, maybe go the opposite direction so that you're not smudging what you've already done. And if you're a rebel, start in the middle and go outwards. All right, so I've got my tree trunk, and then I'm just gonna draw some swoops out to the left and a couple of swoops to the right. Yeah, and you can pretty much see that, right? And then, once I get low enough, I'm just going to color in everything below that with this green. So again, up next to the shelter and right down to my snow. And so I want this green to be strong enough that it covers over the blue and shows up, but I don't want it to be like insanely bold. And then I'm going to do another one, just make some swoops. So this is basically just like your standard kindergarten Christmas tree kind of thing. Again, we want it smaller at the top. And then maybe I'll do one more over here. The way to make a forest really interesting is to make sure that your trees are different heights. So I don't want them all the same height. So this one, actually, I want to be a little bit taller. Right, so I've got kind of a medium tree and then a shorter tree and then a taller tree. All right, and then my tree line, I want to be mostly below like the top of my spruce tree here. So that's about as tall as I'm gonna make my trees go. So they're all behind the shelter until I get to the other side of it. Get over here. And I can make a tree over here. Just got some swoops, and I'm just going to be careful while I'm right next to the shelter and to the snow so that I don't accidentally get green where I don't want it. And I'm just going to be painting some treetops with these nice little swoops. And then just coloring in everything below with green. I hope that you're all finding this relaxing, because I am. It's nice. I can hear my dog sleeping in the background. She's just snoring a little bit. And the only other thing I can hear is my paintbrush. So this is really lovely. We're going to move on to our next step in just a moment. Finish up your green trees in the background. And then we're going to add some texture into our snow here in the foreground and the snow that's up on our rooftop. All right, so I'm going to take a bigger brush, maybe like the one that you used for the background or whatever brush you feel is right for this. And I'm going to mix up just like a nice light sort of bluish purple to create these shadows in my snow. So I'm picking up some water, and then I like my lighter blue for this color. I'm going to pick up some of my lighter blue, and then I'm going to mix in some purple to that. Oh yeah, so I've got like a nice icy purpley blue color. That looks like that. Right. Mike J asked, is the light coming from somewhere? Like the light, do you mean the light that's creating the shadows in our snow? Because if so, it's just kind of like that diffuse light that, you know, comes through the clouds while it's snowing. So we don't really have any super strong light source. But I guess the light's coming more from the back of our shelter because we've got that shadow here. Okay, yes. Yeah. So the light's basically coming in kind of from this direction. You're welcome, Mike. So what I'm gonna do is just have a nice wet brush with some of that color in it and just create a bit of a shadow. So really all this is gonna be is some watery blobs. You don't have to worry too much about exactly where this color goes, because maybe I'll just kind of create something like that. All I'm doing is just kind of scumbling my brush around the paper. And what you can even do too is just get your brush clean first and just kind of scribble around with the brush and some water on that paper, definitely up under the tree, and then pick up some of that nice purple and you can just kind of dab the purple into that water a little bit. And this just creates enough shadow in the snow so that it's not just like a boring plain white bit at the bottom of your paper. But that's really all I'm gonna do for the snow is just like a little bit here and there. I definitely want it to be pretty watery. Because as the paint is kind of pulled around through the water, it's gonna kind of like, I don't know, move around and mix together in a really lovely watery way that's gonna look like just a little bit of a shadow on the snow. And maybe these shadows are footprints from where a hiker was near the shelter, or maybe they're just snowdrifts. With that same color, I'm going to create a shadow on the bottom part of the snow of the roof. So this is just going to be right next to where I made my black line for the roof. I'm going to use my light bluey purple color here. And pretty much just paint one little line down the back and one little line down the front. delightful. And so hopefully you can see that. See that okay? I'm gonna pick up my finished painting and hold it, try and hold it a little bit closer to the camera so you can kind of see. Daylight works better for seeing this, but it's, you can kind of see like a little shadow there. All right. Now, once you're finished with the snow, we're gonna paint some trees in the background of our forest. So these are basically just lines. You can be as fancy or as not fancy as you want to be with them. But I'm gonna be using a medium to small brush, and I'm gonna mix up, basically I'm just adding some black into that purple blue that I had for the snow. And I want this tree color. So it's kind of a blue gray, more gray than blue. So basically just mixing up some black with a little bit of blue and some water. I don't want this to be like a super strong black. I want this to also be kind of watery and more like a wash. So it's a little bit more see-through. Once I've got that color sorted out, I'm going to create my forest. So the way to make an interesting forest is to have your trees not all be exactly the same. So some of them are going to be thicker. Some are going to be wiggling one way. Some are going to wiggle the other way. Some are going to have lots of branches. Some are going to have no branches. So I'm going to start with a tree, and it's basically just a squiggly line to start with. Not very squiggly, more wavy than squiggly. And it's behind my shelter. So it starts like at the top of the shelter. And then I can give it a branch. And so I'll just make another wiggly line that comes off of that line. And then maybe that branch has a branch. Whoa. A couple things to keep in mind with trees is that they are thicker at the bottom and thinner at the top. So you want your trunk to be chunkier down at the bottom and then to kind of taper as it goes off the page. When you are painting tree branches, I like to think of it as like a highway exit, right? So you've got your highway here. And if you're exiting a highway, you don't want to just take a right-hand turn because you're going to die or be very injured or something bad is going to happen. You want to take a nice smooth exit off that highway, right? So we like this guy down here. We don't like this guy up here. And those are smiley and frowny faces for anyone who's wondering. So I'm basically just going to go across my whole forest and create a bunch of these. Oops. Again, I want variety. So some of them are going to be skinnier. Some are going to be fat. Some are going to bend in different directions. They're going to have different numbers of branches. And I'm also going to vary how much water is in this paint. So some of the trees are going to have more saturations. There's going to be less water and more paint in my brush. And that's going to make the tree look like it's closer to me. So I'll paint maybe 5 or 6 pretty saturated trees. And if the whole like branches thing is not working for you, you can just do a bunch of lines. You know, you don't have to create branches coming out of any of them. They can just be straight lines up and down, and that will also look like a forest. And then once I've got some saturated ones, I'm going to add a bit more water into that color. And I'm going to use some less pressure, and I'll just create some more trees that have less paint in them so they look like they're further back. And it's also fun to have your trees crisscross and overlap each other because that's what they do in nature. They're all kind of tangled together. Trees don't have to social distance. They breathe a different way than we do. That's a foreground tree now. Cool. I'm pretty pleased with my forest at this point. There's some thicker trees and some thinner trees, and they're all kind of wiggling their way through the background. So I think that's interesting, and I think that's enough trees. Our fun thing next is to paint our cardinals. Who's excited for birds? Everybody's excited.
We have a raised hand. That must mean excitement. Thanks, Jim. You're really showing your Zoom expertise there.
I'm impressed. I didn't know you could do that.
Neither did I.
Well, I'm glad Jim's excited. All right. I'm going to walk you through a bird first on a piece of scrap paper. It might be a good idea to practice a bird on scrap paper just so that you kind of have a bird to practice on. I find that my birds get better with each and every bird that I do. So yeah, so I'll walk you through one on the scrap paper, and then I'll walk you through two more on your actual painting. If you're feeling brave, go ahead and just paint your bird on your painting. And if you are feeling like you want a little bit of practice first, grab your smallest brush, get that wet, and we will paint a bird together. All right, so my palette has two different reds, and neither of them is like quite a cardinal red, so I'm gonna mix them both together. What might be a good idea for you folks to do is just pick up whatever red is on your palette and try it on a piece of scrap paper first, just so that you know kind of what red you're working with. I'm painting cardinals here. I'm gonna paint two male cardinals because I like the red against the green, but if you wanna paint a male and a female, do one really red and then one a little bit more brown. Or if you wanna do two females, then they're both brown, or if you wanna paint a different bird entirely, make this bird whatever color you want, it's your painting. Anyway, I'm going to be mixing together both of my reds here on my palette. Maybe more the darker red. Yeah, cool. And then maybe a little bit of purple too. Ooh, nice. There we go. That's a cardinally red. All right, now for my cardinals, I am going to be using super saturated paint. So I've got a lot of paint and not a ton of water. Enough water to make the paint move around, but it's not gonna be as watery as all this background stuff that we've been doing. All right, so to make a cardinal, let's see, we're gonna start with his head. So he's got a pointy beak in the front and he's got that nice little crest coming off the back of his head, right? So we're gonna start by just drawing kind of a straight line at about a 45 degree angle. I'm going to make my practice bird really big so that you can all see what's going on here. So this is the front of my cardinal's face. So like this is his beak and then that's his crest back up at the top. Cool. Then I'm going to paint the bottom part of his beak, which is like that. So I've just got like a nice little angle sort of thing going on here. So basically like this is where his beak is. Actually, maybe it's here and then there's his eyeball and then that's his crest. You don't have to draw in this stuff. I'm just doing that so that you know kind of where we're going with it. All right, and then his body, I'm gonna do his little belly first. So this is basically just gonna be like a curved line coming down off of his front. And again, this cardinal is enormous. When you're painting a cardinal and you're painting, don't make him the same size as your spruce tree, unless you're in some sort of like crazy dinosaur long trail world.
Dinosaurs on the long trail, interesting.
Birds kind of are dinosaurs, but how terrifying would it be if birds were the same size as us? If like a chickadee was hopping along and it was like 150 pounds, like what? That'd be cool. Terrifying. Okay, so that's the front of our bird. Then for the back, I'm gonna paint his crest. So this is just gonna be a few like, just kind of lines, parallel lines. When you're painting it tiny, they're going to really touch each other and look more feathery. They look a little bit funky when I'm painting him enormous like this. All right. Then my cardinal's back is just another curved line that's curving in the opposite direction. So basically I'm coming down and he's like a little football shape. He's meeting at the bottom. And then his tail is just going to be off his pointy little butt there. Yeah. I don't have enough space on the one piece of scrap paper, so I'm improvising. And then his tail is just going to be like a couple of strokes. And I'm giving him a forked little tail. It doesn't have to be forked. You can like square it off if you want to. All right, and then once you've got your shape, you can color in your whole bird. And then after he dries, we'll add the black mask for his face. I'm gonna leave my funky little example bird up here, and I'm gonna start painting my two birds on my actual paper here. When you're painting your birds on your painting, it's important to think about where their feet are gonna be. So you don't wanna paint your bird like way too far away from where he's actually perching. I've made that mistake before. And then he's got like really long legs and it looks a little weird. So So I'm gonna start with my cardinal that's sitting on top of my tree here. And actually I'm gonna change how I start so that I know where his belly is. I'm gonna start with that little curved line of his belly. And it's right next to the tree, so his legs are not gonna be crazy long. All right, then I'll do the bottom half of his beak, which is just like a little line sticking out from his top of his little curve there. And then the top of his head and beak is just gonna be a straight line, just like that. And I'll do a couple of little feathers for his crest. And then another curved line that comes down to meet his butt. And then a little swoop off the back for his tail. And then I'll color him in. This one looks a little bit more like a cockatiel than a cardinal, but it's a red bird on a snowy tree, so we know it's a cardinal by context clues. Cool, and I'm gonna do one more little bird over here sitting in our shelter, and he's gonna be facing the other direction, so I'll start with his belly down next to that support. And again, he's got his little beak coming off the front. And then his crest on the back. And then a couple little feathers. The rest of his body and his little tail. Yeah, we can tell that's a bird. All right. Very cool. And I've got a little bit too much water in my birds. They're gonna take another minute to dry. So I'm gonna just paint one more bird because I've got time. While I'm letting these two dry. If you don't want to paint another bird, that's totally fine. If you want to paint 10 more, fantastic. That's an awesome thing to do with your time. Let's see, I'm going to paint him sitting on this part of the tree over here. So I've got his little belly, the bottom of his beak, the top of his head. His back. This is a rock star bird here. Full tail. All right, let's talk about snow while we give these birds another minute to dry before we finish the details on them. In my original painting here, I've got some splatter paint that looks like snow. So if you are feeling cool, if you're feeling good about splatter painting, we can give that a try. Like I said before, the white watercolor doesn't show up amazingly well on top of other colors of watercolor. So we can give that a try. If you have acrylic paint or if you have gouache, that will work better because that's a thicker paint. Also, if you happen to have a white gel pen handy, these are very helpful because that it's just gonna show up like really nicely as a white dot. And it takes longer because you have to like actually draw in every individual snowflake, but a white gel pen is a good way to do snow, or if you have like a white paint marker or something like that. I'm gonna give it a go with my watercolor. The set does have a white watercolor tray with it. So the way that it works best is if you figure out how much water you need, use like the least amount of water while still being able to get it to fling. So let's give that a try. I'm going to use my bigger brush. It's a square brush, so these are easier to flick. If you have an old toothbrush that you're done using, that makes an amazing splatter paint brush because it's got all those little bristles and they're much firmer than like a regular paintbrush, and you can just go and it makes some really nice snow or stars if you're painting a starry night kind of painting, which would be super fun, but a starry night also works best with a white gel pen. But maybe sometime we can recommend that everybody get white gel pens and we do a starry night painting together. In the meantime, we're painting snow. So I've got my medium brush and I'm gonna get that white paint nice and wet and really load up as much white paint as I can into the bristles of my brush. And this might take some experimenting to figure out kind of how much of this paint that you need. So if you have a scrap paper lying around, it might be good to practice on that. Also, splatter painting is messy. If you have something nearby that you don't want paint to get on, move it farther away from you. It is possible to control where this paint goes, but also sometimes it just kind of goes everywhere. So I find it helps to have the brush fairly close to the painting facing, I'm gonna flick it away from me so that I'm not splattering paint onto myself because I've got this great cat sweatshirt that I don't want to get paint all over. Even though there probably is paint on it because it belongs to me. But anyway, so I've got my brush and basically what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna try and, oh, that's barely working at all. I'm just trying to kind of flick paint down. There's paint on my hands, not on my paper. So I think I need a little bit more water. Oh, that worked. Did you guys see that? That's always exciting. So you just kind of have to, oh, and now it's brown. That's not what I want. So there's weird snow falling in my world over here.
Katie, I saw it the first time. It was very cool.
Thank you. And the second time it was brown, but we can just kind of flop that up a little bit and ignore it. There we go. Yeah, so figure out how much water versus how much paint you need. Oh, that was a good one. And then just fling it. And just be aware of your surroundings, be aware of your neighbors. If you're painting right next to people, maybe have like one person splatter paint at a time and everybody else kind of guard their paintings, unless you don't mind splatter painting each other. If you'll remember from one of the previous long trail, art on the long trail sessions, I love splatter painting. I think it's so fun. So the more of it I can do, the happier I am. Oh yeah, that's working so well. Yes. So really it's just experimenting and figuring out how much paint and water you need. Boom, boom, boom. And then you can decide how much of a blizzard you're getting. If you are splatter painting, try to distribute that paint evenly all over your whole painting so that it doesn't look like it's really blizzarding in one place and then there's like no snow on the other half of the painting. But yeah, neat. I wouldn't really worry too much about splatter painting down here on the bottom because that's already white, so it's not really going to show up there, but definitely in the top two thirds of your painting. It looks cool. If you don't want to get your fingers messy, you can take another brush or a pencil or something. I find that this has a little bit less control. I like being able to touch the brush, but you can take another pencil or pen or something and just tap your brush on top of that, and that will also create splatters. And also more noise, which can be fun. If you're listening to music, you can tap along to the beat of the music. Pretend you're part of the band. Two different kinds of art at the same time. What? It's crazy. All right, I'm happy with that splatter paint. Take another minute to do some splatter painting, and then hopefully by then all of our cardinals will be nice and dry and we can give them that lovely black mask, and then our paintings will be done. A really tiny brush. If you have a small black micron pen, this would also be a really good tool for drawing in the mask on your cardinal. Might have a little bit more control than even a tiny brush would. Even if you have like a black ballpoint pen or a felt tip pen, like a really small one, that would work just fine. I'm gonna show you how to do it with the paintbrush because this is a paint class, but I just wanna let you know if you have a pen, that might be a good option for you as well. And definitely if you have a pen and you don't have black paint in your paint palette, use the black pen. All right, so I've got my teeniest, tiniest little brush. I'm gonna get it wet, pick up some black paint, and then, let's see. So I'll show you my demo cardinal first. So I've got this little guy here. Let's see. Yeah, so I'm gonna leave his beak red and then basically just make like a black face mask. Oh, there we go. Okay. All right. So does everybody see that? Cool. Okay. So I've got my tiny brush. I'm going to go to one of my cardinals and I'm going to start by drawing in the back of his beak. So it's just like a little arrow facing away from his beak. And then I'm going to paint like a kind of a circle or a half circle around where his eye is. And then it turns down into a a little bit of a bib just down his chest a bit. Yeah, and that's probably tough to see because it is so tiny and so far away from my phone, but I'll just move this. Let's see. Oh, look at that. So that's what he looks like. And if you don't mind having the picture be shaky for just a minute, I'll hold my phone down here while I paint the next guy's mask. So if that's not going to make anybody seasick, that's what I'm going to do. And then I'll put the phone back. All right. This little back arrow like that. And eyes and face are up here. And you've got a nice little bib like that. Okay. So phone's going back up. And then I've got one more cardinal. Cool, look at that. You just painted a snowy long trail shelter and a tree and some cardinals.
Thanks, Kati.
You're welcome. Nicely done, everybody. Once you're finished with any final little details that you want to do, the absolute last step of a painting is to sign it. You can do that in pen or in paint or on the back, but I like to take some paint, maybe some purple. And I usually sign down in the lower left-hand corner or the right-hand corner, depending on what I'm painting and where the signature looks good. But I'm gonna go down here and I'm going to sign my painting. I like to do my initials. Some people like to do their whole name. Picasso and Monet would write Picasso or Monet. So however you wanna sign it, you sign it. And then when it's dry, you get to peel the tape off and you've got this nice clean edge, and that's really fun too. Mm-hmm. So thank you all so much for painting with me.
Well, thanks so much, Kati. That was wonderful. This is a fun moment. If folks are done, if you've got yours and you want to pull it off the table and hold it up, then we can all act like we're in the same room together painting. Ooh. It's very fun. Oh my gosh.
Beautiful, Michael. Nice job, Ruth Ann. Oh, nice one, Tammy. Oh, I love the squirrel, Anna.
Yes, Anna, that squirrel was cool.
Oh, Kelly, that looks great. Beautiful trees, Daphne. Keep holding them up. I can only look at one person at a time.
Wow, Asha, I think I said that right. I really like yours. The green is amazing.
Oh, awesome. Oh, Ken, nice job. I love your trees. Oh, and Betty, those colors are great. Oh, nice job, Lisa. Oh, I so love it. Life. Did you make yours a card, Morgan? Oh, great bird, Audrey. Oh, and your shelter looks awesome, Sarah. Let me see, I have to move on. Oh, there's so many more on the next page. I'm not going to be able to say all of your names, but these are all so beautiful.
These are great. I like the two next to each other, and the two of you standing next to him with both of them holding up is really fun. But thank you so much, everyone, for putting these. Oh, and Tobin, too. Hey, Tobin, nice to meet you. Hey, Em.
These are great. Good job, Mom and Dad. Those look great.
So while you're all still here, I'm going to ask one thing. I'm going to send you an email, and there's going to be an email in there. We'd love it if you took a picture. And if you sent it to us. So check your emails tomorrow. We're going to try and make a blog post or some type of story of all these great things that have been created tonight so that we can highlight this wonderful evening. If anyone has any last minute questions, you can all, if somebody wants to unmute, that's fine, but our painting project is done for the evening. Go ahead and get some dinner or head out. But thank you so much for coming. There's a lot of great events coming up throughout the winter. So check out the Green Mountain Club's website, follow us on social media. We are going to have more artwork classes. We're going to have more skills workshops, and we're going to have a great slate of speakers about outdoor adventure and inspiration in the Green Mountains. So check those out. And thanks very much for participating and coming back for your follow-up time, or if this is your first, we'd love to do it again. Bye, everyone.
Yeah. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, Katie. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your time and inspiration.
Oh, you're so welcome.
I can see my dog in the background of one of these. That's great.
Thanks, Lauren. Terrific.
Thank you.
Bye, Joey. Good to see you. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Gosh, these are like all of my best friends.
Thank you. Thank you, Katie. Hello, everyone.
Hi. Well, thanks, Katie. That was great.
Yeah, this was so fun.
Bye.
And are you going to be recording up on YouTube?
Yep. So I should have mentioned that. This is everyone that's still here. This is recorded. It'll be on YouTube. I'll send out the link. So you can go back and practice or do a second round. If you want to make, 15 holiday cards for all your best friends, then we've got that right there. So that's really cool.
Yeah.
So everyone that's still sticking on, I'm going to end this, but it was good to have you. Bye. And thanks so much. Look forward to having you for the next one. Have a great evening. Go hiking this winter. We'll Woo-hoo. Talk to you later.
Bye.
Bye, Katie. Thank you again. Bye. You're the best.
I try.
You don't have to try very hard. It comes easy. And bye, Michael Dillon and my aunt and Chloe. Okay.